And so because of that, we need protection, because if we're not careful, we will wander off and do some things that are not pleasing in the sight of God. We have a tendency to be in the wrong place at the wrong time doing some of the wrong stuff. So a good shepherd will take care of the sheep, protect the sheep, provide for the sheep. So David declares that God is a good shepherd. And if you want to look it up, make sure your pastor's not joshing you. John 10:11 says it like this: I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Isaiah 40 says it like this: he shall feed his flock like a shepherd. Now, if the Lord is my shepherd, my feeder, my provider, my deliverer, my right hand, my dwelling place, if the Lord is, then I can conclude that I shall not want for anything that's necessary for my good. Now, we know that David would become king eventually. But in penning this psalm, understand this, David wrote this, Psalms 23, before he was king. That's important for us. David didn't write this from the palace. David didn't write Psalms 23 from a place of comfort and convenience. David didn't write this when he was famous, but David wrote this psalm before he became famous. So let me come to where you are. I'm talking about understanding who the Lord is before you need him to be. I'm going to wait for the internet people to catch up. Y'all. You need to know that the Lord is before you need him to be. Let me say it a different way. You need to know that the Lord is your shepherd before you need him to be your shepherd. Let me say it another way. You need to know that the Lord is your healing before you stand in the need of healing. You need to know that the Lord is Jehovah Jireh before you need him to provide something. You need to be able to declare that if the Lord never does anything else, he's already done enough. So in other words, the Lord is whatever I need him to be. But you need to declare that the Lord is before you need something. David is saying that I recognize that the Lord is, understanding that the Lord will provide when you are fresh out of everything. Understanding that the Lord will provide. So let me give it to you like this. When I say fresh out of everything, I don't mean just physical things, but you need to know that the Lord is when you are out of joy. Anybody, you mess around and let somebody steal your joy. You have some people talking about you now. All of a sudden, you can't smile no more. Now, all of a sudden, you're mad at the world because those people talked about you. So sometimes we're out of joy. We're out of options, and anybody other than me, have you ever been out of friends? You had some friends that said they would be there with you through thick and thin. Come on, by a show of hands. Anybody, they walked away, they said they would be there. When you looked around, everybody except you and God was gone. So you're fresh out of friends, and you're out of family. Anybody, you have some family members, they still not speaking to you after all that you've done for them. Them folks still don't want to speak to you. So you're fresh out of family. Some of us are out of happiness, and some of us are out of hope, and some of us are even out of fellowship. And I don't know about you, but sometimes, anybody ever been out of money? Just a few of y'all. Okay, so you're out of money, and it's gotten even so bad that sometimes you're out of everything. Anybody ever just been out of milk and eggs? You just out of everything. You don't have that. So before you get to that point, you need to know that the Lord is. And then David said, now if that's not enough, if you don't already know that the Lord is, let me help you. He goes further and he says, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures.
Yes.
Now to the natural eye, it doesn't seem like much that he maketh me to lie down in green pastures, but that's probably because we don't understand what green pastures are. Somebody said it this way, don't always think that the grass is greener on the other side. Sometimes it's astroturf.
Right.
Okay, let me say another one. The grass is not always greener on the other side. Sometimes that's fake.
Right.
Like some of those fake friends. Some of those fake church goers. That on the other side, it looks good, but that's because it's the fake. That's because it's astroturf. That's because they fake it and make it. That's because, I mean, they want. wants you to think it's Prada, but it's really not. It's Prada. You just need to get close enough that you can see the U instead of that. They want you to think it's Gucci, but that looks like a G. It's really a C. So it's Suchi or Gucci or somebody. But they want you to think. But on the other side, it's not always peaches and cream.
Right, right.
It does not seem fruitful for anybody to think about walking in green pastures. It doesn't look like a benefit, but it's dry ground. But to those that know God, to those of us that trust and believe God, green pastures means nourishment for my soul.
Yeah, yeah.
So you all want to walk in some green pastures. Why? Because that's where we find nourishment for our soul.
Yeah.
Green pastures mean that He is Jehovah Jireh.
Yeah.
Green pastures mean that I'm never thirsty. Now, I don't mean thirsty like the millennials say. You know how we get. Not us, but some other folks, they get thirsty for people. Right? They're chasing you around, Mr. J. You know what I'm talking about. They, you say, why is she on my tail? That's because she's thirsty.
Yeah.
All right, y'all ask some of the young people, they're going to help you out on your way out. Now, y'all might have missed it, but Martin gave you some saying about people being thirsty, just in case you missed it. But there's some new folks that sing about it too. But green pastures means that I can have what I ask in His name. Green pastures means that I am never alone. Green pastures means that He will never leave me nor forsake me. It means that in the middle of my trouble, I have a resting place. It means that when all hell is breaking loose around me, I have somewhere to go. I have a refuge. He makes me to lie down in green pastures so that I have a quiet place, a place of contentment.
Yes.
Sometimes, when all hell is breaking loose around me, I just need some quiet time.
Yeah,
just
yeah.
Me and God.
Yeah.
Anybody other than me, you just go. You push all the time. And sometimes in the middle of all that, it's not going to stop. There is chaos all around you, and you just need a place of contentment.
Amen.
Can I just lay down in God? I just need my mind to take a break. I just need, there's some thoughts going through my mind, God, and I just need a break. I'm at the end of my rope, and if one more somebody asks me for one more something, I think I just might break. I'm at the end, and somebody wrote a song about it a long time ago, and they said, don't push me, because I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head. And then what they say? Yes, y'all know. So I'm trying not. Don't push me now, because it's been a long 2 weeks. It's been a long day. I still got some more month, but I don't have no more money. Don't push me, because I'm close to the edge. Sometimes, Lord, I just need you to provide some green pastures in my mind.
Yeah, yeah.
I just need some contentment. I'm going and going. God, won't you allow me some green pastures in my mind? And then David says, He leadeth me beside the still waters. But He doesn't let me walk alone. Not walking ahead, but God leads us beside the still waters. I have to want to be led, because then and only then is God directing my path. Watch this. Still waters. What are still waters? Still waters look like joy in the middle of it. Whatever your it is, there can be joy in the middle of it. He can calm the waters while you're going through. Remember last week, the Word of God told us that even in the midst of the storm, y'all remember that He didn't calm the storm until Peter was actually in the boat. So really what He told us was that while all hell is breaking loose, while everything, all this chaos is going on around you, I can speak peace to your soul. That's why the Bible says that He can give us peace that surpasses all understanding. In other words, things might not get good, things might not look good, things might not feel good, but God can give us peace in the middle of unrest.
Yeah.
Recognize that great is His faithfulness. The Bible says that His mercies are new every morning. So thank God for the still water moments in your life.
Yeah.
There might not be a lot of them, but if you get one every now and then, you ought to thank God for the still moments in your life. Then David says, He restored my soul and leads me, not because I deserve it and not because I have earned it, but for His name's sake.
Yeah.
He leads me so that he will get the glory. He leads me because he deserves the honor. He leads me because without God, I am nothing. He leads me because as a sheep, we go astray. And then if that wasn't enough, David says a little further down, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. In other words, in the middle of my danger, notice that in the middle of danger, David's not running.
Yeah.
You're going to get it in a minute. Yeah. David didn't run in the middle of danger. David is walking because the Lord is with him. Now he says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shared this with some of you before, I am deathly afraid of snakes. Yeah, y'all too? Anybody else afraid? I don't mess with snakes. Don't tell me that you got a snake in the crib, because me and you can no longer be friends. At least not at the house. I'll meet you somewhere. We can go to Starbucks, but I'm not coming to the crib because you got a snake. I don't do snakes. I don't play with snakes. I don't mess around with snakes. I'm scared to death of snakes. But here's what I'm not afraid of: the shadow of a snake. Don't miss it. The Bible says that yea, though I walk through the shadow of death, I fear no evil.
Yeah. Mm.
The shadow of death, now a boa constrictor or a real one can show up and hurt you. Isn't that right? But the shadow of the snake, I'm good. I can kick in the shadow all day. Right? Me and the snake, we can work. If it's just a shadow, why do I have to be afraid? So if I'm walking through the valley of the shadow of death, death is just a shadow. It can't hurt me. Because if I'm saved, then I know that on the other side of death, there is the life. So I'm not afraid of it because it's just a shadow. So you don't have to be afraid of death if you're saved by the blood of the Lamb. Because on the other side of death is everlasting life. Don't be afraid of the shadow. David said that the shadow can't hurt me. Here it is. Let me help you. Word of God says it like this. Death has no sting. 1 Corinthians 15 says it this way. Oh, death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So whatever you are afraid of, unless it's the real thing, if it's just a shadow, y'all, it has no power. Though I walk through the shadow, though I walk through what looks like danger, God is with me. And then David continues on and says, your rod and your staff are designed to comfort me.
Yeah.
The only reason his rod and staff were created was to comfort you. Mm-hmm. David is telling us, in the middle of whatever your valley experience is, God is with you and you ought to fear not. Whatever is befalling you this week, fear not. Whatever has kept you up pacing the floor at night, fear not. Whatever, Brother Scott, your health scare is right now, fear not. Whatever your financial state is right now, Sister Rhonda, fear not. You don't have the job yet, but fear not. Because thy rod and thy staff will comfort me. And just in case some of y'all still ain't got it and that ain't enough, David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I don't have to be afraid because you prepare a table before me. See, the table is, you know how sometimes you go to fancy banquets and stuff like that, and sometimes I get upset with people because you get there and the salads are preset.
Yeah.
Y'all missed it. How long that salad been on the table? The dinner's at 6 o'clock. Y'all put that salad out at breakfast time. I know you did because the lettuce is withered. Ain't got no tomatoes on it. Right? They don't put the dressing on until the last minute. How long has it been sitting there? But the Word of God says that he prepares the table before me. Right? In other words, he wants you to see it happening. It's not something that has just been done, something that has been pre-made, like one of them old nasty salads. I'm sure there's some good ones, but I'm talking about the nasty ones. That old nasty salad that's been sitting there for hours. But he said, he's preparing a table in our very presence. He's preparing a table before me. The table is not made up already. The table is not made in advance, but it's prepared in front of me while I am looking. This is going to bless you. While those that despitefully misuse me are looking on, while those enemies are watching, God is preparing a table before me. And then at the table of God, there is no lack. At the table of God, there is no insufficiency. Look, it's right here in the text. Verse 5 says it this way. My cup runneth over. There is stuff at the table that you didn't even know you needed, but it sure is good to the soul. Anybody got a big mama, a buddy, somebody that cook a whole bunch of food like we do family on Thanksgiving? We have to have a pot of dressing for the whole family, and then we have to have a pot of dressing for baby girl, because she wants her own self dressing. Isn't that right? So we got a pot for everybody else, and then we have some specifically for her, because she has to have, and she has to have her own. But David says that my cup runneth over. There's stuff at the table that we didn't know that we needed. And you know, you have some of these people in your family that especially those from the South, when they prepare the food, you're thinking, well, it's just six of us. Where did all this food come from? We can't eat the ham and the turkey and the brisket and the potatoes and the 6 pecan pies and the 8 chocolate pies and the 2-pound cake and the 7-up cake and the peach cobbler. We can't have it all. We want it all, but we can't have it all. And so is the table of God. He has some stuff at the table that you don't think you need, but I declare that if you stay with God just one or two more days, there's going to be something at the table that you might not have needed his help on Monday, but don't you fool yourself, baby girl. Tuesday is just around the corner. There might have been something on the table that you didn't need on Wednesday, but if you stick around till Saturday afternoon, there's something at the table that you won't mess around and need. Or you might not need no healing today, but I declare, just stick around this earth for a few more days, and you are going to be in need of a healing. I know all your finances might be in order today, but just a few more days, if you stick around, the Lord has prepared it, because you too are going to be in need of some finances. There's stuff at the table in a few days. Yes, when the enemy comes in like a flood, you're going to need to know that God is.
Yeah.
When he says, my cup runneth over, there is enough for me and all my friends.
Yeah.
There's enough meat at the table, Dajay. There's enough bread at the table, Dajay. There's enough dressing at the table, Dajay. Enough drink at the table. So much so that David said, my cup of blessings is running over. When we recognize that the Lord is my shepherd, we too can have abundant blessings. Not just enough, but more than enough.
Yeah.
Because we serve an able God. God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly. Just what he said he would do is what God is able to do. Now, I don't know what you stand in need of today. But if you make the Lord your shepherd, you too can have a table spread by God himself just for you.
Yes.
At the beginning of the psalm, David said, I shall not want. But after thinking about it, thinking about God's goodness, David, I often think like me, he gets some holy boldness, right? It's right here in the text. David then says, surely. In other words, I know, sure enough. In other words, confidently. In other words, you can't tell it, Sister Talaya. Let me tell. In other words, I know for myself. And in other words, I've seen, Sister Shirley used to say it like this, I've seen the lightning flash and I've heard the thunder roll. I felt sin breakers dashing, trying to conquer my soul. But the God I serve surely will allow goodness. That ought to be enough. That he would allow goodness. Now David, you would agree, could have stopped at goodness. Anybody ever received the goodness of God?
Come on now.
Pastor Gay used to say, don't move me now. Anybody ever received the goodness of God? Ain't it good? It's good just to receive the goodness of God. And it's really good when, has anybody received the goodness of God even when you didn't deserve it?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody ever received the goodness of God and it wasn't because you were good, it was just because God is good? So David could have stopped at goodness. Okay, my sister got it. You could have stopped at goodness, because that's good enough. David could have stopped right there, but because God is good, the Bible says, and his good is everlasting, so goodness was enough. But because we serve a great God, David said, not only his goodness is following me. Y'all still looking at Psalms 23? Look at Psalms 23. Y'all know what's next. Not only is his goodness following me. Y'all got it? Y'all looking at me? Look at Psalms 23. Not only is his goodness following me, but then David said, if that's not enough, I'm going to send some mercy.
Yeah.
Your way. So then he said, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Lamentation says it like this. His mercies are new every morning. So they followed me from yesterday, but this morning when I rose, I had some new mercies. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm just bad enough and good enough all at the same time that today is Sunday. So on Saturday, I used up all the mercy that God had for me. On Monday, I'm going to use up all of the mercy that God had. So on Tuesday morning, a brother going to need some more mercy. Well, the word of God says that every morning when you roll over and hit your alarm clock, you ought to thank God that you got some new mercy. That every morning when you wake up because the alarm clock went off, you ought to thank God that it's another day and you got new mercies. When you look on the end table right next to you before you put your teeth in out of the glass, you ought to thank God that on that same table you got some new mercies. You ought to thank God not just for whoever might be laying next to you, but you ought to have enough sense in your own self mind to thank God that it's a new day.
Yeah.
And because it's a new day, I've got new mercies. He says, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Now, when we were born again, this life is not the end.
Yeah.
Oh, glory. This life is not the end. So goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I'm living this life to live again. Yeah. And since the Bible can't lie, if goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, that must mean that it will follow me into the next life. When this life is over, I've got a place not made by man's hand. I've got a better place. And as good as you might think this world is, as great as the offerings of this world might be, it does not begin to compare to the glory that shall be revealed. Here is how we know. David said at the end of verse 6, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever, as long as I live. Well, after this life, I have another life.
Yeah.
And I will still have goodness and mercy following me. Here is how we know. John 14 says it this way. In my Father's house, there are many mansions.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you, and that where I am, I will come again to receive you unto myself, so that where I am, you may be also. Goodness and mercy. It was enough. He could have stopped at goodness, but because God is so good, he said, I'm going to give you a little bit of mercy, Jessica, because I know there's some things that are going to happen in your life, and goodness might not be enough, so I'm going to throw in some mercy. In this life, goodness and mercy in heaven. Goodness and mercy. Yeah. You might be pleased with what you have. You might not be pleased with where you are. You might not be pleased with what you have, but you ought to thank God for his goodness and his mercy.
Yeah.
Let me help us, and I'll be out of your hair. The word of God declares to us in the Hebrew translation, there are some words that don't appear in the Lord's Prayer. There's some things that were added just so that we would understand how good he is. We should be able to say, the Lord, my shepherd. The Lord, my shepherd.
Uh-huh.
Remove the ears and just say, the Lord,
my shepherd.
The Lord,
my shepherd.
That's all you need. Who else? The Lord,
my
shepherd. Somebody told me last week that Pookie is just about to get out of jail. And they were serious. His name's not Pookie, but whoever he is, he's just about to get out of jail. And she didn't get him out early this time. But understand that even Pookie needs to be able to say, the Lord, my shepherd. So if he is your shepherd, then you ought to be able to call on him. And when you call on him, he will answer.
Yeah.
When you need him, He's always there. Don't believe it? I'm going to say this and then I'm going to be done. Try calling on some other things. I know you've been waiting all morning to shout, so I'm going to give it to you right here. You can dance a little bit and we're going to go home, right? So call on some other things. Call on Muhammad just for a minute and see what happens. Call on Buddha and see what happens.
Yeah.
Crickets. My girl, Erica Badu, said sometimes you even try calling. See what happens. This is going to be your shot right here. We're going to go home. Call Muhammad.
Yeah.
Nothing happens. Call Buddha. Nothing happens. Who else we call? And nothing happens. But when you call on the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Now I read this in Thompson that he can do what he does and he ought to be happy about it. So I no longer have to wait for verse number 6 to get my blessing. I can see my shot. I can see my praise in the Lord is.
Yeah.
That's all I need. The Lord is.
Dot.
What else you need him to be? Come on now. You ought to be able to thank him for the Lord is. I said the Lord is. We already called Buddha. Nothing happened. We already called Muhammad. Nothing happened. And then we took a note from Erica by newspaper. We called Tyrone and nothing happened. But I declare, somebody said, I heard Big Mama say that the more I call him, the better I feel. So if you need something from him right now, I declare that you ought to just say out loud, Jesus. And then tell him what you need. Come on now, somebody else than me. Just say, Jesus. Now tell him what you need. Come on, say it again, Jesus. And now tell him what you need. I don't hear nobody. Come on, open your mouth and tell him what you really need. Say it one more time, Jesus. Now tell him what you need. Don't miss it. Somebody else say, Jesus. Well, I know you stand in need of something. You ought to open your mouth and be bold enough. You serve a big God. Stop asking your God to start your car in the morning. You know your car gonna start. You paid $12,000 for it. It's gonna be all right. Stop asking him to give you something to eat in the morning. You got a whole bucket of oatmeal. You know what you're gonna eat in the morning. Stop asking him to give you something to eat when you go home at night. You got some leftover Red Lobster. You know what you're gonna eat. Ask your big God for some big things. You ask your big God for healing in your family. You ask your big God to save your son. You ask your big God to save your daughter. You ought to be able to say, the Lord is. Come on, let me help. The Lord is my healing. Say it with me. The Lord is my healing. The Lord is my deliverance. The Lord is my finance. The Lord is my salvation. The Lord is everything that I need. The Lord is my eternal life. The Lord is. David said, I recognize him enough to know that the Lord is. Whatever it is you need him to be, just open your mouth and cry out, Jesus. Don't call Muhammad now, because we already said that ain't nothing going to happen. Don't call Buddha. We've already checked out Fat Buddha. Nothing happened with Fat Buddha. We've already tried to call Tyrone, and he didn't answer. But when you call on the name of Jesus, somebody says, I declare, the more you know it. Come on now. You have to open your mouth. Ain't got some of y'all been waiting all week. You ain't said the name of Jesus all week. Now is a good time for you to call Jesus. He's bigger than your heel. He's bigger than your diaphragm. He's bigger than your kidney failure. He's bigger than AIDS. He's bigger than diabetes. He's bigger than arthritis. He's bigger than a miscarriage. You ought to be able to call on the name of Jesus. Whatever you need, the Lord is.
Yeah.
Open your mouth and then cry out, Jesus.
Jesus.
Come on, somebody do it like this. Tilt your head back just to look up to heaven. And as loud as you can, come on, everybody in the neighborhood to hear now. I'm going to give you just a minute or two, but I want you to say Jesus out loud. There's some people outside that might not know who he is. It's your one chance to help somebody get close to Jesus. Now, we're going to do this on the count of three, but I need you to say Jesus like you really need something. Now, if you don't need nothing, just sit in your seat and look cute. But if you need something from God, I might not be able to help you, but I know somebody, and his name is Jesus. One. Two, you got to tilt your head back and look up and glory. You need to be delivered from some stuff. You need some stuff in your life. You've been waiting for 20 years for God to deliver you. Now you want to put down the cigarette. You want to put down the crack pipe. You want to put down the bottle. You want to stop sleeping around. You want to be committed to your bed. Two. So you ought to tilt your head back just a little bit. You got your wig skinny and good. It won't fall off. Just tilt your head back a little bit. If it fall off, we'll pick it up and give it back to you. But just tilt your head back a little bit. If you're not too ashamed, if you're not too ugly, if you're not too nasty, you ought to just holler out, Jesus, if you stand in need of something, because I have found that when you need tuition, Jesus is able to give you tuition. When you need a way to be made for your new car, God is able to do it. On the count of three, just tilt.